one short story. After this, we're going together to the Marat HaMachpelah. So one story, we know that one of the big teachings of Rav Fruman was that religion is the source of so much of the conflict. The idea, belief in God, could separate people, but could also link them together again. So if religion is part of the problem, it has to be part of the solution. A few weeks ago, Michal was in the Marat HaMachpelah on a Friday. She was the only person in the entire cave. And she thought this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. She started to pray. And suddenly, the muazzin, with all its racket, starts going off. But then she just can't continue with all that noise. But if you can't beat them, join them. So she decided to focus her prayer together with the muazzin. And she noticed it's actually a very beautiful voice. So she asked me on that Friday, is it really a person singing, or is it just a tape? So the following Sunday, I was going to visit the group of sheikhs from Hebron that I meet. So I thought I'd ask them. So one of them, I asked him, is it a real person, or is it just a tape? And I see that Sheikh Ahmed gets very moved. He goes, a tape, it's my cousin. So he sent Michal's warmest regards, and yeah, okay, and
thank you. I want to start this by thanking Rabbi Yaakov for the invitation, and thank you all for gathering here today. It's definitely a historic meeting. It is not often repeated, but it is my wish that there'll be more sheikhs and imams that come and speak at your beloved yeshiva here. And also, I look forward to the moment where Rabbi Akiva could come and speak in a gathering of Muslim scholars as well. My name is Omer Salem, and I studied at Yale University in the West. Coupled that with my PhD dissertation at Al-Azhar University in Cairo, Egypt, which is my native country, actually, Egypt. I was born and grew up there before the whole family immigrated to the U.S., where I worked and studied there. So let me begin. And as in the beginning of every talk, in a gathering of religious people like this, in Islam we say Bismillah wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. In the name of God we begin, and we pray peace and blessings on all the messengers of God. Today I will actually share with you some information as to why are you finding so much struggle out there in terms of people saying insulting words and so forth at Jewish people, and what in other words, what caused them to say these things, and what sort of understanding of the message of Prophet Muhammad, or what sort of understanding of the Quran, would lead to something more positive in the relationship? Let me just begin by the story of Islam. Why was the book called the Quran revealed in the first place? I brought a copy here of the book. This is the Quran, and this book, it's about 600 pages in this style or format, was revealed to Prophet Muhammad in Mecca and Medina, as you may have studied in some of your studies. But before this book was revealed, we learned from the Quran that there were two other books revealed to Prophet Muhammad. There was revealed to prophets that preceded Prophet Muhammad. We acknowledge Moses, peace be upon him, as the prophet of the Israelites, who had the benefit of the Torah. The Torah was revealed to Prophet Moses, and it's praised in the Quran. So the Quran praises the books that you are studying. And later the Quran also tells us that many prophets came to the people of Israel, Bani Israel. We call them in Arabic Bani Israel. Those prophets, including Yusha alayhi salam, Dawood or David, Solomon, and many other prophets are all documented here in the Quran as being the prophets of Bani Israel. The Quran contains only 25 prophets, actually, and messengers, of which there are five prophets that are considered the main prophets in Islam. Ulul Azm min al-Rusul, that's the Arabic term for that description. Starting with Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, and Prophet Muhammad. So those are the five prophets that are considered the main prophets of Islam. Now, the Quran tells us that all these prophets came with one message. There's only one God to worship. La ilaha illallah is the main statement put together and put forward by the Quran. And Allah reveals that this is a statement that's been uttered by all the prophets that preceded Prophet Muhammad. And then it's uttered also in the Quran that Prophet Muhammad was the seal of all prophets. In other words, he was the last of God's prophets. So we understand that the Quran was revealed, but before the Quran there were the Torah and the Gospel. Some people might ask, why do we need the Quran? Wasn't it sufficient that we had the Torah and the Injil? Or just one book would be sufficient for mankind, for humanity. God answered that question in the Quran. Why was the Quran necessary? The Quran was necessary, as revealed in chapter 16, verse 64 of the Quran, for the purpose of clarifying to the children of Israel, or to Ahlul Kitab, as the name is used here in the Quran, those things which they were bickering about, those things which they were fighting over. And the most problematic thing they were fighting over, the most significant problem the children of Israel were fighting over, was what to do with Jesus. What to do with Jesus Christ? What is he? Is he a man? Is he a God? Is he nothing? What to do with that? So that conversation is recorded here as to the fact that the children of Israel were quarreling over that, and it was necessary to bring the answer to that in the Quran. And and at least to me as a scholar, it gave me reason not only as to why the Quran was revealed, but also why that message in the Quran spread over so vast an area in such a short time. Because within 100 years of Prophet Muhammad's death, religion, the newly founded religion of Islam, encompassed areas extending east as far as present-day Iran or Pakistan, and extending west to Spain. So that's a huge and vast area for a message to spread. And most of this area was covered by Jews and Christians. So why did the Jews and Christians really found interest in what was revealed to Prophet Muhammad? Apparently they found interest is because it answered certain questions that were plaguing them that they couldn't answer given their books. The reason, like I mentioned, the Quran was revealed is to address certain questions. But there was also, after the Quran was revealed, we had books that were written throughout the ages. Those books caused followers of Prophet Muhammad to start breaking into different sects and different schools and so forth. And that leads us to why nowadays some scholars in Islam would call non-Muslims kafir. The word kafir, you should really know, you should know that. Kafir is a term that means someone who doesn't believe. Now, how did it develop from someone who the Quran reveres, who has a message like the Torah, to being called a kafir? This developed because certain scholars wrote text that said that certain books have been changed. The Torah has been changed, the Gospel has been changed, and therefore they cannot be relied upon. And because you could not be relied upon, then anybody who follows those books cannot be following authentic text. And that's why you find the struggle here over this land, over the Holy Land. The Torah calls this land, it gives it two names actually, it calls it lands of the Philistine and also calls it the land of Israel. Both names are found in the Torah. The struggle we have over this land, at least in my mind as a scholar, is mainly because it's there is a huge understanding, a misunderstanding in the minds of many religious people as to whether the Jewish people are really people of God or not. If you are counted as being people of God, then by all means there should be peace, there should not be any conflict. In order to do that, one will have to I'm here in Israel today, I see that you respect your books, I see that you respect your religion. To me, you are not what other people tend to describe about, or say about the Jewish people. And whenever I see a synagogue, I say, here are people who are really worshiping Allah the best they can, based on the books that have been revealed to them. And that's why I also would encourage you to think of people who are worshiping in a masjid, as you walk by a masjid, that here are people who are worshiping Hashem, Adonai, in the best way they know how, because they have the revealed revelation. With this conciliatory remark, I think I'd like to conclude and ask if any of you have a question. I'll be glad to answer those questions. Yes, please.
You said that Jesus is mentioned in the Quran?
Yes, Jesus is mentioned in the Quran.
In which context?
Okay, Jesus is mentioned in the Quran in the context that he brought a message to the Israelites of his time. He was a prophet to Bani Israel, according to the Quran. And he brought a message to correct some of the practices that were taking place at the time. And he was an acknowledged messenger from God, but he was not a God himself or a son of God in the context of being divine. One could say that he was a son of God in the context that the Bible described Solomon as being the son of God. I think in one of the books of the Bible described that. So, but is not in a divine sense. So Jesus is mentioned here as a prophet of God, like David, like Solomon, like Zechariah, like John, like many of the biblical prophets. And that's what that mention is all about. Yes, please.
What the Quran or the Islam says about Jerusalem?
Okay, the question here is, what does the Quran or what does Islam say about the city of Jerusalem? Okay. The city of Jerusalem is not mentioned by name in the Quran, but it is mentioned by reference. There are two major references in the Quran to the city of Jerusalem. And it is mentioned in the context of Masjid al-Aqsa. It says, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-Aqsa. And this is in Surah number 17 in the Quran. The Quran says that this is a revered city, this is a city, a blessed city, and it says that it's a city that should be respected and should be revered. It doesn't say anything else that I can think of aside from what I just mentioned.
You said that one of the reasons for the Quran to be given was because people didn't know how to what to think about Jesus and what is.
Yeah, because over the time, certain tribes of Israel who believed in Jesus elevated him to the level of being worshipped, and certain followers of Jesus. I don't want to say followers, but I want to say there were those who rejected him, and called him not a prophet, not a Messiah, called him names and called his mother bad names and so forth, and it's all documented here. That argument is here.
Yeah. So you said one of the reasons for the Quran to be given was to put order in that.
To give the solution for that debacle between the Israelites, because some of them were believed in what Jesus brought and some of them rejected what he brought.
Yeah.
Those who believed in what he brought elevated him to the level of God, and those who rejected him brought him down to the level of Satan. So the Quran said to both sides, wait a second, Jesus is not God, but he's also not Satan. He is but a messenger of God who's bringing a message to the people of Israel.
Yeah, so my question about that was, if when Jesus came with God's words to people and nobody knew how to take it, so why would the Quran giving another revelation to somebody, why would that be incorrect?
Yeah, because if everybody took what the message of Jesus, what it is as it came down, and did not start worshiping Jesus, for example. I argue then all the Israelites would have been just one group. There would be no splits, and there would be no reason to send a third message. The third message was sent to reconcile between those two groups, where one group elevated Jesus to being worshipped and the second group said he should be condemned.
Yeah, but I just didn't understand, why would the third message be taken better than the second message?
Well, because the second message by God was to correct something within the the Tanakh, within the corpus of learning by the Hebrews at the time. And the third message was to reconcile between those two fighting groups that arose after the death of Jesus, started fighting with each other as to whether Jesus, what's the nature of Jesus, and whether he should be worshipped or not. Okay, please.
I want to continue the subject of Yerushalayim, of Jerusalem. So, in addition to what you said, can you explain, please, what should happen by your knowledge and by the Islam, according to the Islam and the Quran or the Hadith, in the Mount Temple? And I'll explain, because when we pray at least three times a day for the temple to be built, we also pray for all of the nations to come and pray with us in Mount Temple, but, I mean, it should be instead of the Dome of the Rock that there is right now over there. What do you think the Islam say about this specific place?
Okay. Here is what the Quran says about, first of all, about the land in general. Okay. This land around Jerusalem is described here in the Quran, not in the same terms it was described in, say, the book of Exodus or the one before it, the book of Genesis, where it is described as the land of the Philistines, and later on the land of Israel. The Quran does not mention the land of Philistines or the land of Israel. It mentions Holy Land. So God chose to reveal to Prophet Muhammad that to call this land the Holy Land, according to the Quranic text. And then it also told the Israelites who were having problems in Egypt during the time of Moses, leave Egypt and come to the Holy Land. It didn't tell them leave Egypt and come to Israel or come to Philistine. It says leave Egypt and come to the Holy Land. The Quran has it that when they came to the Holy Land, they built a place of worship, commonly known as the Solomon Temple, or, you know, the other temples they built. So after they did that, while they were in the Holy Land, as we know from history, certain events took place and their kingdom split into two kingdoms, and later their temple was destroyed to be rebuilt again, and after the appearance of Jesus Christ, it was destroyed one more time. The Quran mentions that after it was destroyed the second time, Prophet Muhammad, like I said, was sent to the world with a message to try to reconcile, like I said. The verse actually says not only that he tries to reconcile, but he is a wahudan wa rahma lil alamin. Let me just mention the ayah in Arabic and then I'll translate. وَمَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا لِتُبَيِّنَ لَهُمُ الَّذِي اخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةً لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. We've given you this message so that you would explain to them things that they are quarreling over, the children of Israel are quarreling over, and as guidance and mercy to mankind. So that's the purpose of this message. Now, how does this relate to the city of Jerusalem or the Temple Mount? Everything I do in my research tells me that Islam is not about statues, structures, pieces of dirt. It's about building human beings, not about building statues or building mosques even. It's not about building mosques, it's about building a human being. So with that in mind, In Islam, whether this land is populated by Muslims or by people of the book, which Actually, this is another term that I like you to know, and it's in Hebrew. It's called the Oam Sefer.
I'm a
Sefer. I'm a Sefer. Okay, I'm a Sefer. So this term Ahlul Kitab, I'm a Sefer, is mentioned in the Quran in many verses, and it's said that some of the I'm a Sefer were really true believers, and some of them deviated from what God has revealed. So whether this land that we're standing in now is populated by people who are Am Sefer or Ahlul Kitab or people of the book, or it is populated by Muslims, that's not an issue in the Quran. The issue is that it should not be ruled by kafir. And unfortunately, there is so much misunderstanding out there that Jews are kafir. You see what I'm saying? I have to be honest. I cannot just play, around. So
the Jews are perceived as kafir by certain
scholars out there, and they're writing books along those lines. So what needs to be done is to show in many ways that Jews are not kafir. They have a religion. They respect their religion. They respect their faith. And God commands us here in the Quran, in chapter 5, verse 48, He's revealing to Prophet Muhammad, saying, لِكُلٍ جَعَلْنَا مِنْكُمْ شَرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. To each of you we have given a way and a path to Allah. Okay? So there is a way and a path to Allah by people who study the Tanakh, like you do here at the yeshiva. There is a way and a path to Allah by those who study the gospel, and there is a way and a path to Allah for those who study the Quran. And God has decided that. And then He said, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَجَعَلَكُمْ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً. If God has willed, He would have made you all one nation. وَلَكِنْ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ فِي مَا أَتَاكُمْ. But Allah didn't want that. He didn't want you to be all one nation. He wanted you to be tested on what you're given. Wants me to be tested on what I'm given, the Quran. Wants somebody else to be tested on what they're given, which is the gospel. Then what do we do with each other? It's also mentioned in the same verse, in the same ayah. It's number, chapter number 5, verse number 48. It says, فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. So what does that mean? This is an Arabic term that means that you as a Jew, me as a Muslim, and let's just say we had a Christian here, are commanded to compete for mitzvot, to compete for good deeds. That's what we're commanded to do among each other. We're not some of the challenges I'm facing and many Muslim scholars are facing is that many books were written that this Quran has came down to trump this Torah, meaning that this has no value anymore. According to them, this has no value. Okay? So, Allah doesn't say that, but certain scholars wrote that. And because of those books that are written out there, we have something called abrogation. Abrogation meaning one book cancels the other books. So if you get Muslims whose belief is that, oh, this is old fashioned, this is just, it's gone, it's no longer valid, and this is the only thing that's valid, they're going to think that if you're following this book, you're not, part of what God wants you to do. So this concept of abrogation is what's causing us trouble today, in today's world. And this concept needs to be, and that's why learning, and that's why, I encourage some of you to be a scholar in the Tanakh and in the Quran, and learn, and also debate with Muslim scholars, because for me, for example, to be able to debate something with Rabbi Yaakov, I need to know a little bit about the Tanakh, I need to know the books, and so we can have an intelligent conversation. I want you to be the same way with Muslim scholars. By learning what the Quran say about Ahlul Kitab, and it touches you because you are here, you are in this land that's claimed by somebody else saying, no, you don't belong here, you should not be here, that's the sort of thing. So knowledge is going to be the key to dispelling most of these problems. And Islam, like I said, is not about stones, is not about masjids. Islam is about good, sound human beings who are kind to their neighbors and who are worshiping God. Oh gosh, okay, done.
Dr. Salam wrote a 600-page doctorate on this topic about the people of the book. And I was very surprised because I would think a ancient Islamic university in Cairo would not. I was very happy to hear that they were open for an approach of like this. I would love to hear some of your experiences. Did you meet opposition in presenting your thesis among people there that thought differently?
yes. Thank you, Rabbi Yaakov, for the question. The question is, did I meet resistance in bringing this topic? And also, not only bringing this topic has been studied, but to say that the resistance I met was to say that they're not all kafir. That was the resistance, because I'm going against minds in high learning places that say that you're all kafir, that you're all mushrik. So to go against those and say, wait a second, no, they're not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, and I had to bring out the verses that says laysu sawa'a, which means they're not all the same. They have the mu'min and they have the kafir. They have just like us, like Muslims have the same thing. So I had to bring that, and I had to bring proof from the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad and what later scholars wrote to be able to defend the fact that each tradition has those who are obedient to the law and those who are not obedient to the law. So this was definitely a challenge for me, and I'm thankful that this actually I managed to get through across to the professors who discussed my dissertation. Also, I had to fight for the concept of abrogation. Mm-hmm. Abrogation is very prevalent in the Muslim world. Mm-hmm. Many of the Muslim ulama, and so the ulama means a Muslim scholar. They call it alim, and the plural form is ulama. Many of the Muslim ulama are saying that the Quran has canceled the books before it. So that's another obstacle that I was. It's like I'm defending your books in front of a committee. by saying no, there's something valid here, and if there is something screwy here, if something is wrong here, I'm not going to be the judge of that. I'm going to leave it up to their conscience and to God in the hereafter. That's all I'm saying. That's how I presented my argument to them. So then I also said, just like you don't want Jewish scholars to come and tell you that this book has all kinds of errors and so forth, I don't want to be the one judging their book, just like you don't want them to come and judge my book. Anyhow, I did meet many challenges in writing and presenting and so forth. But you know, thank God that it went through.
Did the acceptance mean some level of agreement with the conclusions?
With the conclusions, yes. The acceptance means some level of agreement with the conclusions, absolutely. Yeah, go ahead.
What about places in, I guess, either tradition or in the Quran, I'm not sure, that it's more against Jews, as in, like, the Jews behind the tree come and get like that?
The hadith of the stone and the tree. He's probably referring to that hadith hiding behind the stone, the tree, and so forth. Well, there is a hadith as part of the Islamic corpus that I have not fully researched, but I heard from Muslim scholars. Not only the hadith, but I heard some of them saying that it may not be an authenticated hadith yet, but it serves a political purpose. That hadith tend to serve a political purpose, and that's why it's being aired out there for people to hear. The hadith talks about that there's going to be a day of judgment or a big war, and the Jews will hide behind a tree, or a stone or something like that, and then the tree will say, "Okay, here's a Jew behind me. Come and kill him." But then the hadith also mentioned that there's certain kind of trees that are not going to say anything. The hadith says that the Jews here in the Holy Land are planting those trees. It is something that definitely I need to research more. The question of at the end of the day, it's the question of believing or disbelieving. A question of believing that there's a God who sent messengers and who has a law, and if we are obedient to that law, we are close to God, and if we're disobedient, we're cast away from the mercy of God. That's really what's important to me as a scholar. Please.
I wonder what is, if you can explain to us a bit about Dar al-Islam and Dar al-Harb.
Dar al-Islam and Dar al-Harb. And Dar al-Muhadana. Yes. Over the years, because Islam spread so wide and so vast, certain scholars sat down and authored some books, and put in those books that, and then they divided the world into a land of war, a land of peace, a land of muhadana, which is where there is agreement between the parties, like hudna. So they divided the world into those three categories. This is called ijtihad. And to translate that word ijtihad means it's a scholar's opinion. It has no roots in the Quran. Absolutely, I did not see it in the Quran. I have not even seen it in the corpus of hadith by Prophet Muhammad, Dar al-Harb, wa Dar al-Silm, wa Dar al-Muhadana. But I have seen it in the tradition, in what those ulama have written. Unfortunately, again, when what they wrote serves a political purpose, then they pull it off the shelf, they dust it off, and then they start disseminating the information. But let's go back to what the Quran says. The Quran says, all land belongs to God. Inna al-arda lillah. It's a very straightforward, very clear in black and white Arabic text. There is really no such thing as a land of peace and a land of war. If you are at peace with yourself, the entire world is a land of peace. If you hate yourself, if you're at war with yourself, the whole world is basically at war with you. So again, I'll go back to the fact that Islam is about building the human being, building the soul, not about possessions and land grabs and all that. thank you.
I'll give a little question.
Yeah. I'll let you select who you want.
How can I choose everybody so?
In the how do sheikhs and imams decide on a fatwa? Fatwa?
Yes.
How they decide on a fatwa?
Okay, that's a very good question. How are fatwas issued?
Can you explain what is a fatwa?
Yeah. Okay, let's explain what a fatwa is. And you should really know that, because it affects everybody. When they issue a fatwa, it affects everybody. A fatwa is a religious decree. It's a decree based on... thank you. Yeah, it's a decree based on religious teachings. The fatwa is usually obtained when the mufti. Okay, so mufti is someone who gives a fatwa. Okay. So a mufti, before he is able to issue a fatwa, he would, let's talk about a hot topic, like the jihad. Okay, does anybody heard of jihad? Anybody in this room heard of jihad? Okay, so to give a fatwa about jihad, the person who is given the fatwa reads all the verses in the Quran about jihad, and then takes the 9 books of hadith, sunnah, and brings all the hadith that talk about that particular topic, jihad, for example. And then, in addition to those two corpus of knowledge, he would also read what other imams before him or other mufti has have wrote on that subject. And then he sometimes also is influenced by what the ruler is saying. Because after all, he's a mufti, and most of what he's doing is religiously related, but he's not governing the region. So sometimes you find that the ruler, it's in the best interest of the ruler to do to declare jihad. And in that case, he would read all these things, and then also takes into account. He takes into account. The consensus of the people and the ruler. And sometimes he issued a fatwa, and the fatwa could be in accordance to what the people want or against their wishes. It doesn't matter, but it's just fatwa based on the constraints of his of the text that's before him regarding a certain topic. Yes.
Can you explain about the Islam caliphate idea?
Islam Khilafah, Khilafah, Al Khilafah Al Islamiyah, like ISIS, for example. Okay, Daesh, yes. Okay, so here's what's happening. Muslims, because of what has been happening to them over the last 100 years, many of them are now desiring to have a Khilafah. Okay, it is their desire. It is like, let me just give you an example, of a historic example that's relevant to you in the room. Once upon a time, the Jewish people had a nation, had a country, had a kingdom called the Kingdom of Israel or the Kingdom of Judea. And then certain events took place, and then all of a sudden they found themselves all over the place. And then they found themselves subjugated by the nations who had, you understand subjugated, or should I explain? Okay. Abused. They found themselves abused by the rulers in the nations that they were residing. To a certain extent, something similar to that happened to the Muslim Ummah. They lost their Khilafah when Turkey, when the Ottomans were disseminated, the Ottoman Empire was disseminated. And because we lost the Khilafah, at the time they said, fine, okay, we agreed to be divided, and they agreed, and now we have like probably out of the Ottoman Empire came about 40 countries around the region and so forth. So they found themselves being subjugated or abused by either the rulers or by foreign powers. So they sat down around the table and said, you know what, nothing going to solve our problems unless we have a Khilafah. We need to get the Khilafah back. It's like we need to get Israel back in order to protect the Jewish people. That was one of the reasons why people flocked to this part of the world. The same way with Khilafah. The Muslims think that it is a certain rulership of the Muslim Ummah is what's going to protect them against being abused, harassed, whatever. We all know that there was a war in Iraq, there was a war in Afghanistan, there was wars in many, many parts of the Muslim world. And it is not, unthink of for some of the Muslim scholars to get together and say, well, you know what, the only thing that's going to save us from being chopped and killed all the time is to have a khilafah and have a khalifa. Now, I would like to argue that a khilafah is not necessarily bad for Israel. Most people think, oh, no, if there's a khilafah, there's no Israel. If there is Israel, there is no khilafah, because there is also on the other side. They say, oh, if there is, if Israel continue to exist, there cannot be khilafah, or if there is a khilafah, Israel cannot exist. I really like to take a different approach with this. I think both can exist. There is enough. I hope there is enough wisdom in human beings to realize that, just like Muslims think that they need protection of a caliph, the Jewish people need feel that they need a protection by having a state that that protects them. And I wrote in my dissertation that when the day comes and we have the Jew who lives in Israel can have a cousin or a brother living downtown Cairo, dressed up in his Jewish garb, sending his kids to school, going to his yeshiva, and feeling safe, the same way he feels in Israel, solving the Israeli-Palestinian debacle would not be a problem at all. Please. Yeah, with the hat.
Can you see any future which there is same Khalifa in Egypt and in Iran, with Israel in the middle,
mm-hmm.
which means both can exist?
Okay. Okay. Okay, so the question is, what happened if there is a Khilafa and Israel is in the middle of the land of Khilafa? That's what I understood from the question. What will they do? I gotta share something with you. Jews have lived under Christendom in Europe, and they also lived under what's called Islamic states or Arab states and so forth. History tells us that the Jews of Europe under the church suffered a lot more than the Jews who lived in Arab countries. That's a historic fact. I don't have to really debate that much. And there is a reason for that. The reason is that Jews historically have been accused of killing the Christian God. Okay? Killing Jesus, who is considered a God by our Christian brothers and sisters. So because of that, they have had difficulty with living in Europe, and there had many, many atrocities that took place there. In the Arab world, Jews lived, like, for example, I mean, here in Israel, when I was here in Jerusalem 2 days ago, I visited with Egyptian Jews who happened to be Qarain, the Karaites. It's a sect of Jews who lived in Egypt for thousands of years, and also their distinction from the rabbinic Jews is that they hold their views that the Tanakh is their only source of learning and understanding, and the Talmud is secondary, and they don't really have to rely on the Talmud. Those Jews tell me that they had no difficulty whatsoever living in Egypt and under Egyptian laws. But also other Jews who, aside from the Qarain, other Jews who lived in Morocco or in Iraq, ask any Iraqi Jew, and they'll tell you that they never experienced the kind of difficulty a Jew in Europe. Like a friend of mine came from Poland here in Israel, and he said that there were 3 million Jews in Poland at one point. Today they're less than 50,000 or 5,000, you know, some really, really small number like that. The idea is that, yes, Jews can live and live with dignity, because that's what I want. My vision is to see Jews living with dignity in the Arab world, in the Muslim world, like their ancestors have lived. And we all know the story of Spain, where the Jews lived in Spain when it was ruled by Arabs, and they had some of their best years. They even called them the golden years of Spain, until the Arabs were kicked out and the Inquisition took over, and we all know what happened in history after that. Okay, thank you. Yes, that gentleman.
You're saying that there was treated well more than in the Europe place, but according to history, the Jew were not treated well in the Muslims countries. You see the law of the heights, that a Jew cannot be on a horse or other things. So
okay,
they're not always been treated.
Okay.
Treated,
sure. There is a question. Okay, there is a question here as to whether the Jews were really treated well in the Muslim world or not. And our friend here is citing that they would not build a building that was as high as the neighbor's building and so forth. to answer that, all I tell you is that throughout history, minorities in any country, not necessarily Jews, but in any country, can experience rulers who would give them status and favor, and they would also experience another ruler who would give them less status and treat them as second-class citizens. It all has to do with politics. It has nothing to do with the religion of Islam. So just like you're citing times when Jews were mistreated or they were treated as second-class citizens, there has been times where Jews held the high positions in government and even led the military of a Muslim nation. And it's all documented in history. And this was in Spain. Okay, the one with the headphone on.
What role?
Sometimes from an eye of looking from outside, it's looked like that the Arabic nation and Arabic society is very aggressive society, even upon himself, not only upon other people. Like sometimes we hear about stories about killing inside families, about honor family,
honor killing.
Two families fighting between two families. So mm-hmm. I really wanted to ask, what is the Quran opinion about murdering, in conclusion, not only against other people?
Yes. The Quran came to tame these vicious Arabs. Arabs are used to being very, very vicious. They lived in mostly desert, and they had tough demeanors. The Quran came to fix some of these ailments. And whenever the Quran is absent from an Arab's society or an Arab environment, then it reverts back to things like what you have just alluded to, like honor killing or dispute between families, where someone would even just pull a gun and kill his brother. We hear of these things. These are let's just say tribal feuds that existed prior to the message of Islam. At the time of Prophet Muhammad, they were fighting something as small as what you tie a camel with, like a string that you tie the camel with,
a leash,
over a camel leash. they would fight and many people would get killed over that. And those stories are there and they're documented in history. Islam came to tell them that, hey, you shouldn't be fighting over this, there's a God, you should be a better human being and so forth. But unfortunately, in many areas in, today, this book of this God's book is put here behind. It's and then people are just walking with this book behind them. When this book in the front, things are different. When this book in the front, people are kind. And speaking of kindness, let me just share something with you. The Quran asks me as a Muslim to be kind to other people. Over the years, some scholars came and wrote, no, you should only be kind to Muslims. And this is another argument. Should I be only kind to Muslims and be a jerk to everybody else? The Quran doesn't say that, but certain scholars wrote that. So you can just imagine. So if you have someone who living here is your neighbor, Palestinian or something, and he is not kind to you, it is not because he doesn't want to be kind to you. It's because he read the wrong book. And if he reverts back to the Quran, he is going to be kind to his neighbor. And it doesn't matter whether his neighbor is a Jew or a believer or an unbeliever. We have ample of examples in the history of Islam. Thank you. Yeah, go ahead.
First of all, let me just thank you for coming and talking to us. It's very comforting to know that there are people like you out there spreading the word. I would like to add that I don't think that we're fighting today against Muslims.
Okay.
The Islamic nation. I think we're fighting against people who hate us just because they follow the wrong scholars or
yes.
Whatever you said. So what can we do today?
Very good. Now here's a question. Let me paraphrase this question because it's an important question. Our friend here. What's his name?
Noam.
Noam
means pleasant.
Yeah, pleasant. It's the same in Arabic, Noam. blessings. Noam asked a very good question. He said, we in Israel don't think that we are fighting Muslims. And I want to second that and tell you, yes, you are not fighting Muslims who are following the Book of Allah. Because if they are following the Book of Allah, first of all, they're going to be kind to you. And they are not going to be saying, oh, you have been wrong somewhere else. You should go where you've been wronged and you don't have a place here. Because that's an argument that has been leveled. If the Jewish people have been wronged by Europe, by what the Europeans did, then they should take a parcel of land in Europe and give it to them, not come here. Your question, Noam, is what should we do? What should we do with people who mistreat us? If we're trying to live in peace with our neighbor and the neighbor is being hostile against us. I would say that Israel has done pretty good by because where I, you know, I go in Israel and I see, for example, you have a kibbutz and you have a wall around it. Why are you having the wall? It's because somebody's outside the wall wants to harm whoever is inside the wall. I would say continue to live the good moral values found in the Torah. Continue to live those good moral values. You will prevail by following the moral values found in the Torah and being true to them, than by violating those moral values and saying, okay, you know what? I'm going to put these moral values aside, and I'm going to go in and just, you know, destroy this neighborhood or destroy this village because somebody there who is just always trying to attack me. And also another point that's important is we described in this talk that the reason they are your neighbor is doing what they are doing is not because they are relying on the Quran, but it's because they are relying on what certain scholars wrote later on and then attributed those writings to the Quran. But I look in the Quran, it's not there. It is not there. So in you inviting the other side to read their Quran, inviting them to come close to their Quran, you'll be serving yourself, you'll be serving them. And this is not, I'm not here trying to convert anybody or anything like that. No, by all means. All I'm trying to say is know the Quran so that you can present it to the people who respect this book and invite them to respect this book.
But one of our problems is that even when we do... one of our problems is that maybe we could work things out with people that listen. But
yes.
A lot of people that don't listen.
Okay, then what you do is you get the people who listen to talk to the people who don't listen. You don't talk to them. You just, like, okay, so let's just say there is a room that has 20 people, and let's just say 5 or 6 of them listen, and the rest they don't listen. Then it behooves you, for the people who listen, to be the ones who talk to their compatriots and cause their compatriots to understand it in a way that helps everyone. Okay, so please.
Could you explain the concept of antakia?
Okay. There's a question here in the hall to explain the concept of tuqya. Okay, so let me try to explain what does it mean, tuqya. Tuqya is an Arabic word that comes from taqwa, and it comes from fear. Tuqya is predicated on fear. It's like when they say ittaqullaha mastata'tum, fear Allah, be fearful of God. So tuqya is a concept that has been developed over the ages, and it's not only within minorities in Islam, but it is within minorities in many other traditions. It's a concept where if I'm a part of a minority, I hold certain beliefs that are dear to me, and I feel that if I share those views or those beliefs, I'll be persecuted. I could be killed. I risk losing a limb. Then my outside appearance would say that I'm agreeing with the majority, when I hold views that are not in agreement with the majority. But I'm doing this because I am afraid that if I aired my views, I would be persecuted. Tuqya became prevalent within the religion of Islam when certain minority groups in Islam held views that were other than the mainstream, held views that were considered antithetical to mainstream Islam. An example of that would be certain groups within Islam who said that Prophet Muhammad's cousin should have been the Prophet, and that the Archangel Gabriel came down wrong and gave the message to Prophet Muhammad, and he should have given it to his cousin. Or certain groups that say that there is no God but Ali. Ali is a cousin of Prophet Muhammad. So they elevate Ali radiallahu anhu to the level of being equal with God, even worshipped. So those views, when aired in a Muslim context, the person can be persecuted. So he doesn't say them. He hold them. He keep them to themselves. So that's how that concept was developed. Okay, this gentleman with the cap has been trying, and then the red. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, the red is in for me.
Okay, you? Okay.
I want to go back to the beginning when you said that Islam came because of the Christians and the Jews, that the separation of the nation, and Islam came to bring everyone back together. And, like, let's face the facts, it did the opposite in those three groups that all hate each other.
Yeah.
So,
that's a good question.
No, so based on that, shouldn't there be like a fourth message now?
That's
a fourth message.
No, we have a revival of the third message actually, to try to reconcile, because the question was. If Islam came to reconcile between the children of Israel, between Jews and Christians, and from what we see, that has not happened. In fact, Islam has, you know, the Muslims have failed to do that. In fact, we have three groups now that hate each other, all three groups. Do we need a fourth message or a fourth prophet to try to bring reconciliation between the traditions? The answer is either that, or we need the people who espouse to hold the third message that was supposed to be a message of reconciliation, restore them to that role. Restoring Muslims to the role of being a place to reconcile between the children of Israel is definitely a worthwhile goal, and is definitely something that's going to bring peace to the Jews here in Israel and to Christians and to Muslims all over the world. That's my view on that.
Can I you mentioned in your paper in Yale from the Rabbi Ben Amozeg.
Uh-huh.
And he points up Elio Ben Amozeg. He wrote a book called Israel and Humanity, and he interprets the closing verse of the book of Prophets about the mission of Elijah, which is in Hebrew, V'heshiv lev avot al banim v'lev banim al vatam, to reconcile the father and the children, as seeing an era that Judaism and the religions that developed emerged out of Judaism as being finding reconciliation. So that's...
Yes, thank you for adding that. With the glasses, go ahead. And then after you, we're going to have the one in the...
Okay.
The back, all the way in the back. Yeah, go ahead, you first.
It does relate to the hot topic. What does Islam have to say about the jihad?
Okay, what does Islam have to say about jihad? Okay, I have to make a confession here. Can I make a confession in this room? As if I haven't made many confessions already. The confession I want to share with you is that Muslims worldwide are going about jihad the wrong way. And that's why we're seeing so much bloodshed between Muslims and non-Muslims. And now we're seeing bloodshed within Muslims. Muslims are today killing each other in the name of Allah. Okay, and this is all antithetical to what a message, you know, the religion of peace. Islam comes from shalom, from the roots shin, lamed, mem, and it's peace. So how come the religion of peace is out there slaughtering everybody, and then when it's not busy slaughtering everybody, it's slaughtering itself, slaughtering its people? It's because of misunderstanding jihad. Let me tell you something. Jihad, you have two forms of jihad. The greater form of jihad and the minor form of jihad, the small form of jihad. The greater form of jihad is mentioned here in the Quran, has nothing to do with the sword. The sword is a minor form of jihad that apparently everybody's just going that way because it's the easier way to go. The harder way to go, which is mentioned here in the Quran, in surah by the name Surah Al-Furqan, in verse number 52, I believe, it says, وَجَاهِدْهُمْ بِهِ جِهَادًا كَبِيرًا. There is a revelation to Prophet Muhammad to use this Quran as his jihad. So it's jihadul kalima wa jihadul saif. The jihad of word, of truth, of word. And then there is the jihad of the sword. The jihad of uttering truth, the jihad of inviting people to be to love God and to love their neighbor and to be honest in their dealings. That's called jihadul kalima. And that's what the Quran calls the greater jihad. The minor jihad is jihadul saif. And you cannot win, I profess to say as a Muslim, you cannot win jihadul saif or the minor jihad until you have conquered jihadul kalima. You have given a chance for people to know and to see an example in you. I mean, you have to be a good example. I mean, like, for example, in the United States, I am sometimes baffled because when I invite somebody to Islam to tell them, okay, I think you should really, I'm talking to somebody who, for example, doesn't have any religion or something like that. And I tell them it'd be good to read about Islam and consider embracing Islam. And what they tell me is this: which Islam are you inviting me to? Are you inviting me in the Islam that's in the life of the Muslim people? Or are you inviting me to the Islam that's in their books? Now, I'm confused by this because I don't know how to answer it. Here's why. If I tell him I'm inviting you to the Islam that's in the life of Muslim people, he'll say, I see them killing each other today. And if I tell him, well, no, wait a second, forget about them. I'm inviting you to the Islam that's in the books. He'll say, well, wait a second. What kind of books are they reading that's causing them to kill each other like that? I have to invite him to what's in the Quran. Because what Muslims are reading, honestly, they're not reading the Quran. They're reading everything else but the Quran. And I'm really being honest. Despite the fact that we have something in many parts of the Muslim world called Musabaqat al-Quran al-Kareem, Hafz al-Quran al-Kareem, which is competition. As a matter of fact, you can open the window a little bit. It's getting stuffy here. Competition for memorizing the whole Quran. Mm-hmm. We have competitions memorizing the whole Quran. But here's the challenge. People memorize the Quran and they don't understand what it says. They just memorize and repeat things that they don't understand. So what we need in the Muslim Ummah today, and I don't know why I'm telling this to you, but I'll just say it anyway, is that people who understand the Quran more than people who memorize the Quran. If we understand just, like two pages and apply them in our life, is better than to memorize all 600 pages and not apply anything in our life. Okay.
You told Noam about speaking to Muslims who are willing to listen, letting them spread their message. And I just want to know, how would you spread your message in more extreme places, for instance, in Iran or Saudi Arabia and other places?
Yes, thank you. How would I spread my message of reconciliation in extreme places? For Me personally, what I do is I talk to scholars, and I find among those scholars, those who agree with the views I'm just expressing. By the way, these are not singular views. What I'm reflecting here are views who that have been espoused and embraced by many scholars out there, but they just lack a sponsor and a podium. Those scholars lack a sponsor and a podium, but they do exist and they're out there. And if any of you come from a family with means and you want to sponsor something like that, we could talk about it. To spread the message, I go one-on-one, eyeball to eyeball, belly button, toenail to toenail, and speak to the person. Just like the biblical prophets used to do. Did they send emails? They didn't send any emails. Did they go on Facebook? No, you don't do any of that. It's easy for me to say, oh, okay, well, let's just do emails and Facebook and all that. But that's not nearly as effective as being there in person, presenting the message, getting their agreement on it, and then two of you continue with two more and so forth, and that's how the message propagates. Thank you. Oh, the last question.
In Judaism, we have the Talmud, which is almost entirely accepted, besides by the Karaites. So when you talk about the Islamic scholars that have views about are they like ancient scholars or modern scholars, or are they scholars widely accepted, scholars not so widely accepted?
Okay, let me try to understand this question first. In Judaism, we have the Torah and the Talmud. The Talmud is widely accepted, except by a minority position or a minority sect. The question about Islam is, do we have, are all the books accepted by all the Muslim ulama? Is that really the question? Do we have a minority? In Islam, we have many, many sects. And, you know, unfortunately, I stand before you today to tell you that we have so much historical divisions, and we have present day divisions as well. But all accept the Quran as a source, as a guiding source. When it comes to secondary books, like the equivalent of the Talmud in the Jewish tradition, we have the 9 books of Hadith. Now, there are two major groups of Muslims today. There is a Sunni and the Shiites. You may have heard that. Sunnis worldwide represent close to 85 or 90%. Shiites represent 10% to 15%, which are large numbers. I mean, you know, 10% of a billion is a lot of people. So we have the books of Hadith that are considered canonical by the Sunni group of Islam. Some of them are accepted by the Shiites, and some of them are not. And the Shiites have their own books of Hadith. Those books of Hadith, and that's another challenge that we're having in the Muslim world, is that the books of Hadith that we have over the years had many sayings that were attributable to the Prophet Muhammad as having said it when he really have not said it. So there were many fabricated Hadith and many weak Hadith, meaning that the chain of connection from the person who said it to the person who heard it from the Prophet is broken somewhere. So we have a challenge and a need to authenticate many of these books that are being used, because we have books that are used where ulama or scholars rely upon to say that all Jews are kafir and they should be eliminated.
Part of the nine
so,
books?
It is in fact, unfortunately, part of the nine books, but they're not part of the two. There are two main books of those nine books that are held as canonical. One is called Bukhari and one is called Muslim. Those books don't have such wording, harsh wording, but in other books there have been those wordings. If I had to say something, I would say that there's influence by political motivation at the time or something like that that caused them to write something of that nature and attributed to Prophet Muhammad as having said it. Well, with that, I want to thank you very much for being here with you, and I want to thank Rabbi Jacob. Thank you. And you can email me if you need to. Thank you.